everyone. Stand and sing these songs with us this morning. Put those hands together. It's a good day to praise the Lord this morning as we lift these up. Sing it out.
For the praises of man, I will never, ever stand. For the kingdoms of this world, I'll never give my heart away. For shout my praise, my allegiance and devotion, my heart's desire and all emotion. Go to serve.
This morning, I know you know this one, crown him with many crowns. That's our God. We want to crown him this morning. Sing this out.
Crown him with many crowns, the Lamb upon his throne. Our color heavy anthem grounds, all music but its own. Awake my soul and sing of him who died for thee, and hail him as thy matchless king through all eternity.
Crown him the Lord of life, sing it to him. This morning, we want to lift him up, and we want to remember all that he has done for us. Amen? This is a song called We Will Remember. Let's remember what he's done for us. Sing it out.
We will remember.
Sing it out. Sing it to him.
We will remember. We will remember. We will remember the works of your hands. We will stop and give you praise, for great is thy faithfulness. You're our Creator. Sustain. back at all you have done. And we will shout, our God is good and he is a faithful one.
Hallelujah, sing it out.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, to the one from whom all blessings flow.
This morning.
You can do better than that. Give him a hand clap. Thank you. You know, one of the ways that we remember, sometimes in the pit, this is our message today, it's our third part in this series. One of the ways that you get out of the pit is you praise your way out of the pit. Sometimes when you don't feel like singing, you sing anyway, because God does something. See, he doesn't have a memory problem. We do. We forget his faithfulness. When we're faithless, he's not. He's got enough faith to fill all of us, and he wants to do it in your life. So we just praise him today because he is faithful, so we remember all that he's done. Don't have a memory problem. Don't have a memory problem. Think about the little things. We're so blessed. We're so thankful today for all that God is and all that he's done for us. So he is such a good God, and that's why we give a good song to a good God today. So I pray that you've already participated in worship. If you'll just take your worship guide with you, you know, school's starting this week, so you don't have an opportunity to go anymore to Wally World. I mean, Dollywood, I'm sorry. You have a last-minute opportunity. And so school starts, so the little ones are going back in, and some of you will be free, as free indeed. So if you'll notice on the front, we're in our third part of our series on Out of the Pit. On Sunday nights, we teach in room 305, Unveiling the Future, the book of Revelation. So if you're interested in a smaller setting, that would be an opportunity for you on Sunday night. Also, if you'll take a look inside the bulletin, we've got a lot of things that are starting up. Children's promotion, if you'll look at that on the left, that's next Sunday, August the 2nd. And also for nursery workers, there's a luncheon today. We'll all show up for that. We will never miss a free meal, Summer, so we can multiply that thing. I know we can. So anyway, that's for today. There's a lot of ministry opportunities. There's one I'd like to call your attention to, and this just keeps us on the grassroots level of our mission. I want you to look in the middle. says, giving life away opportunity. The schools, we have a great relationship with all the schools, and we're not just an Alcoa church. We've got Maryville, people from Knoxville. We've got a lot of opportunities to minister outside these walls, but specifically, there's an opportunity, if you want to give life away, to pray and be a part of something at one of the schools. So you'll see that in the middle, missions opportunities, and then on the back, if you'll, let me call your attention to something here in the middle. You can tell I'm prepared for this. Summer does a much better job, but the library, I'm telling you, for a church our size, we've got a tremendous library, and they've got, I use it all the time. I just never check out a book because I use it during the week. They don't know I get it, and I put it right back where it goes, and that's called grace. And so, but I'm telling you, if you're a child or an adult, it doesn't really matter. There's opportunities for you. And the library's this way, out these double doors. And so take an opportunity to read that. Also, the Pregnancy Resource Center. We support, by the way, we're pro-life. Let me say it again. We're pro-life. We value children. You can see them running around here all the time. We value children around here. We support them financially. Here's a great opportunity for you to participate if you want to know more. Now go to the back. I teach a class on August the 16th. If you're a guest with us today, we're glad you're here. It's a very informal time where you can ask questions. I kind of go over our mission and our vision and some of the values that we have, and it's an opportunity in room 104, which is down in the basement. You can take an opportunity to be a part of that. Also, you can take an opportunity to look at our TV schedule and help someone that needs to be ministered to in that way. Well, listen, we're really glad you're here. If you're a guest, man, it's a special opportunity for us today that you would choose this church out of the thousands of churches you can choose on any corner in the South. You chose this one, and we pray that God would minister to you today. So we're going to take an opportunity to just greet everybody in here and make everybody feel welcome. Let's take that opportunity. Today we're going to be talking about getting out of the pit of loneliness. Loneliness is a gift that God gives us. So we're going to kind of talk about getting out of the pit, but in a way staying in the pit, because loneliness is a good thing in some ways. And Jesus talks about this in his prayer in Gethsemane in Luke chapter 22, verses 39 through 41. It says, "Coming out, he went to the Mount of Olives, as he was accustomed, as his disciples followed him. When he came to the place and said to them, 'Pray that you may not enter into temptation,' and he was withdrawn from them about a stone's throw, and he knelt down and prayed, saying, 'Father, if it is your will, take this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done.'" And so in this particular passage of scripture, Jesus valued loneliness. He actually called a prayer meeting, and then he left the prayer meeting that he called to go and pray. He called the disciples to be with him, and yet he withdrew from them. And so in this particular passage of scripture, we learn to withdraw. We learn to get alone with God. And that's Gethsemane's gift to us, which we're going to be talking about today.
Sing it out.
Your presence in this place, your glory on our face, we're looking to the sky. Descending like a cloud, you're standing with us now. Lord, unveil our eyes. Your love is within. Your love is within.
to him.
Show us your glory. Show us your power. Show us your glory.
Father, thank you for this day. I thank you for what's already been done in your house, Lord, and just pray, Lord, that you would be with us in all that we say and do. Bring glory and honor to you. And now as we give back to you the part that you've given to us, Lord, just take it and use it to furtherance of your gospel. I pray this in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
say. And never once and did we ever walk alone. And carried by your constant grace, held within your perfect peace. Never once, and no, we never walk alone. And never once did we ever walk alone. And never once did you leave us on our own.
Can you say amen to that? He's faithful, absolutely. Give the Lord a hand. He's so faithful. And when you think about that song, it sets up the message in Luke chapter 22. If you turn there, it sets up that we're never alone. Jesus was never alone in this garden that we're going to look at. And so it's very important that you understand, when you feel lonely, there's value in loneliness when you understand that you're never alone. And so we're going to look at that as we do our third part of the series, Out of the Pit. Now, there's going to be some ebb and flow and some tension and some squeeze in this message, because there are times when you need to understand that God wants you to stay in the pit a little longer than you think you should stay in the pit. There are times when he orchestrates circumstances in the pit to let you and I know that we're never really alone. And there's always going to be a time when you go through the valley, when you go through the pit or you're in the pit, but there's going to be a way that you come out of the pit. And in this particular passage, it says, and an angel came and strengthened Jesus on his way out of the pit, Gethsemane. And so we're going to talk about loneliness today, loneliness today. We've talked about depression. Is anybody in here depressed? Yes, okay. Last week, we talked about worry. Did anybody worry between last Sunday's message and this week? Thank you. Good. Me too. And the third thing we're talking about is loneliness. And next week, we'll talk about suffering out of Psalm chapter 22, suffering. So this is a passage where Jesus is going to, in a sense, go into the pit of the Garden of Gethsemane, and he's going to be squeezed. God's going to squeeze him. And let me say this to you. When you're squeezed, that's the real you. Whatever comes out is the real you. When you're squeezed, when there's the pressure, where there's a pressing, and that's what Gethsemane means, then that's the real you. And so we're going to see in this passage of Scripture the value of loneliness for a while. So if you'll stand out of honor and respect of God's holy word, Luke chapter 22, 39 to 51. Coming out, and I'll explain that in a moment, he went to the Mount of Olives as he was accustomed, and his disciples also followed him. When he came to the place, he said to them, pray that you may not enter into temptation. And he was withdrawn from them about a stone's throw, and he knelt down and prayed, saying, Father, if it is your will, take this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done. Then an angel appeared to him from heaven, strengthening him. And this is when he's coming out. And being in agony, he prayed more earnestly. Then his sweat became like drops of blood falling to the ground. When he rose up from prayer and he had come to his disciples, he found them sleeping from sorrow. Then he said to them, why do you sleep? Rise and pray, lest you enter into temptation. Verse 47, and while he was still speaking, behold, a multitude, and he who was called Judas, one of the 12, went before them and drew near to Jesus to kiss him. But Jesus said to him, Judas, you are betraying the Son of Man with a kiss. When those around him saw what was going to happen, they said to him, Lord, shall we strike with the sword? And one of them struck the servant, the high priest, and cut off his right ear. Can I explain something to you here? The guy had to duck. If you're going to cut off somebody's right ear, Luke is a doctor. If you're going to cut off his right ear, you're going to cut his shoulder. The implication here would be the guy ducked because his head was being swung for. Now think about that. And we'll explain it here in a minute. But Jesus, in the midst of this chaos, but Jesus answered and said, permit this. And he touched his ear and he healed him. Father, we come trusting you for garden experiences and lessons that come from Gethsemane in a very lonely place. Father, there are some people here in a crowd today, but yet they're lonely in the very crowd they're standing in. It is possible to be with a crowd of people and still feel lonely on the inside. So I pray that you would help us in this third message of Out of the Pit series to deal with the value of loneliness for a while before we are brought out and brought to the mission and the purpose. Sometimes we have to go through the valley. And so, Father, even as we've sung through the valley, you're still faithful. And so we thank you for that. And I pray that you would teach us in Jesus' name. Amen. So here we are with some lessons, some life lessons since school is starting. Let's look at the lesson, first of all, of loneliness. The lesson of loneliness. There's value in loneliness coming out of the pit. The Bible says coming out. Coming out, this is Gethsemane, all right? He went to the Mount of Olives. He went to the Mount of Olives. The Mount of Olives is a mountain range that's just right before you make your ascent to Jerusalem. It's a mountain range. You have to go, if you're going to go to Jerusalem, you have to go through the Mount of Olives. There is no straight shot to Jerusalem. There are some hills and there are some valleys. Now, there's no straight shot to godliness. There are some hills and some valleys when you get to the point of godliness, when you're striving to move toward God. It's not a straight shot. There's hills and valleys. And so when it says he's coming to the Mount of Olives, this was a mountain range just outside of Jerusalem. And the Mount of Olives was a place where olive trees would be, obviously, and they would harvest olives, if you will. In this Garden of Gethsemane, is actually where the squeezing would take place and the harvesting would take place, but Gethsemane, in the language of the New Testament, would be a place of squeezing, where oil is squeezed. And the way that you harvest an olive is, I mean, you may think it looks pretty on the outside and it tastes good as you eat an olive, but the way that an olive is useful is you have to have, and this is what they would have in ancient days, they would have some sort of a container that was solid on the bottom with a heavy, heavy rock on the top, and then they would put the pit. The way that you would get olive oil is you would crush the pit. It's not peeling off anything from the outside. It's when you're squeezed and when you're crushed. And so Jesus is going to the place where he's going to be crushed. God is going to squeeze all out of him what he's put in him for this moment as he goes to the Garden of Gethsemane. Now, let me explain two gardens for you so that you understand. First of all, in Genesis, there's the Garden of Eden, and that's the Garden of Sin. That's where the Bible says that Adam and Eve fell, and there was sin that entered the world. So that's the garden. It was a garden of life, but then it became a garden of death. And then there's another garden in Revelation 22 when we end this great study in Revelation on Sunday night. We're only in chapter 6, but when we end it, there's another garden-esque picture. It's a garden city, and there's going to be the tree of life and the new heavens and the new earth. And so in between the two gardens, the garden of Eden over here and this picturesque garden in chapter 22, there's a garden of Gethsemane where
Jesus was squeezed, where he was squeezed and he was crushed. And the Bible talks about that he was crushed for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was put upon him. And so the understanding of that Jesus was squeezed here in this Garden of Gethsemane, in this Mount of Olives. So that's what they would do. They would squeeze that pit and that pit would be crushed. And they would use olive oil for all sorts of things, for anointing, for healing, for all kinds of things. So if you ever get a chance to go to Gethsemane, you'll see the Mount of Olives, and you'll see at the bottom this base, the Garden of Gethsemane, before you cross the Kidron Valley. And so that's the picture. So if you never get to go to Gethsemane, can I tell you something? You will have a Gethsemane in your own life. You'll have a place where you're squeezed. You'll have a place where it's dark. You'll have a place where you'll need to come out of. And that's what the text says. Look at the words, coming out. Coming out, he went to the Mount of Olives. Now, there's the Mount of Olives, there's the Garden of Gethsemane, there's a Kidron Valley. And a Kidron Valley is a place where things are opaque and turbid, if you will, kind of muddy, kind of obscure. And that's the way it is oftentimes in our walk with God. We can't see things real clearly. And so the idea is that before we get to this mountaintop, before we head to Jerusalem, before we move toward that place of Zion, which is a symbol of godliness, then we sometimes have to go through a garden experience. And we oftentimes want garden friends to go with us into the garden experience. Verse 39, coming out, he went to the Mount of Olives. Now you know what that, as he was accustomed. Jesus would oftentimes go to this particular place. Oftentimes, the city of Bethany was just right outside of there. He would visit Martha. He would visit his friend Lazarus, whom he raised from the dead. He would often do teaching. He would minister, be ministered to, and rest in this Garden of Gethsemane. All right? And that's the way it is in our lives. And when we want to get out of the pit, sometimes we go through something, but we're there to minister, we're there to be ministered to, and we're there to rest. And Jesus, this was a familiar place for him. And just outside of there would be a familiar place, because it says, as he was accustomed. That's what the text says. And his disciples followed him. Verse 40. Then he came to the place. He said to them, pray that you may not enter into temptation. Now, let me give you the first point. This is a lesson in loneliness. This is a lesson in loneliness. Jesus called a prayer meeting, and then he left the prayer meeting. He called a prayer meeting, and he said, pray with me. And if you'll remember, in the upper room, he told them that he was going to die. He told them about the crush and the weight of what he was sensing he was going to accomplish. And he called a prayer meeting, and then he left the prayer meeting. He called them to himself, the scripture says here. Look at this. Get the visual here. He called them to himself. Be with me. Stay with me. Pray with me. Help me. I need you guys. And then he left the guys to fend for themselves because he withdrew from the very people he called together. That's what the text says. Do you see it here? When he came to the place, he said to them, pray that you may not enter in temptation. And then it says, verse 41, and I'm kind of getting ahead here. He said, and he withdrew from them a stone's throw away, and he knelt down and prayed. Some of the loneliest times in your life may be lying next to somebody who has no idea what you're going through. See, the disciples couldn't even relate. Jesus called a prayer meeting. He withdrew from them because he understood the value of loneliness. He understood the value of his relationship with God the Father. He understood that he needed to rest. He understood that he needed to minister. He understood that he needed to be ministered to. And this was one of those times where he was segregated. He was divided. He called a prayer meeting, and then he left the prayer meeting to pray. Here's the reason. Write it down. He called his friends, not his primary support. Secondary support. Secondary support. He knew what he needed to get through this time of being in the pit. He knew the value of loneliness. He knew that he needed to be alone. What happens when your friends let you down? What happens when garden friends let you down? You know, the problem with a lot of us, we like to tell everybody about our problems, and therefore we have 100 people in our garden. We have 100, come get in my garden, come get in my garden. Oh, here, I want to invite you. Hey, I want to broadcast it. Here's my garden. And then everybody come running. They come running together. Hey, listen, there are some people in your garden that don't need to be in your garden. What you need to learn and what I need to learn is we need to pull away from the crowd, because there are things that God wants to say to us in solitude that he can't tell us when we've got so many people around us hearing so many voices. Jesus is a great model here. He knew that he needed to stay in touch. He knew what he needed to do, but he pulled away from the crowd and he learned the value of loneliness. Are you here this morning trying to cling to people who can't meet your needs? Are you here this morning saying, Lord, I have so many needs in my life. My heart is crushed. I feel squeezed. I feel broken. I feel brokenhearted. But Lord, if I start getting all these people involved in my situation, I'm going to miss you. And Jesus would be a great example. He called his friends as secondary support, not primary support. And that's what you have to learn in the value of loneliness. Listen, Gethsemane is a gift to those who like to cling to people. It's a gift. It's a gift from God to say, hey, you know what? All you need is me. You just need me, because they're not going to hang with you in prayer. They're going to fail you. Garden friends, got you. Snore. That's the way it is. And that's the way God's designed it. There's nothing wrong with having people value you in prayer and being with you in prayer and bearing one another's burdens, but you have to pull away from the crowd, and you have to get with God and say, God, I want to know the loneliness. I want to value loneliness. I want to know it's just me and you, and I want to know, what do you want me to do in this situation? Solitude strips us like nothing else. What happens in that moment when you pull away from the crowd and all the noises and all the people you've invited, and you say, Lord, talk to me, speak to me, minister to me? And what happens if there's very little between you and God? Be still and know that I am God. Jesus learned the value of loneliness. We see that in the first point. Look at the second part of it in verse 42. Here's what the text says. And here's what he prayed. Oh, the Bible says he withdrew from them about a stone's throw. Now, some of you can throw a stone farther than I can. I'm a used to wuzzer. I could throw a stone farther than most of you. But when you get 50, your arm doesn't fling like it should. And so a stone's throw away is a euphemism for the fact that it was a short distance away. So you get this picture here. I want you to get this picture here. These guys come into the garden invited by Jesus, and he said, thank you, but no thank you. I don't need you. And then he withdraws a stone's throw away because he's contemplating the sins of the whole world being borne on his shoulders, and they're concerned about sleep. That's how different it is. And so the idea is, let me give you a second thing that you should learn, and that's Gethsemane's gift. When you're in the pit, this is a good thing. Verse 42. Here's what he prayed. Father, if it is your will, take this cup away from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done. And so there's a lesson in the crisis of the will. Not only is there a lesson in loneliness, but there's a lesson in the crisis of the will. There's tension there. I mean, Jesus' humanity comes out like never before in this particular passage. This is his humanity coming out. Hey, he was bargaining with God. Think about that. Have you ever asked God for a plan B in your life? Have you asked God for plan B? Lord, I'll serve you, but could we have a multiple choice test here, Lord? Because I'd really be better if with multiple choice tests. Well, do you have a plan B? See, Jesus is here, and he knows he's going to do the Father's will, but basically he's saying, if it is your will, take this cup away from me. Now, notice the phrase away from me. This is very important. He's already withdrawn away from them. He's already withdrawn away from them to get in solitude by himself. And now he's saying, take this cup away from me. Now, what is he saying here? Lord, if there's any other way to save humanity, hey, Lord, God, if you're the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, you met the Hebrew boys down in the pit. You met Daniel in the lion's den. And would you mind cutting me some slack, Abba, Father? Would you mind cutting me some slack? And that's the way we do a lot of times in our life. There's a crisis of the will. When God's will is presented to us, we have a crisis in the will, and we have tension. Now listen, when God tells you to do something and you don't do it, that's disobedience. That's Jonah. That's not what we're talking about here. But there are times in our life when God tells us to do something or go through something or be squeezed in a situation, and we don't want to do it, and we say, Lord, if there's any other way, let me know. Jesus was saying that. I picture it like this. Lord, if mankind can be saved by being nice, let's go that route. If mankind can be saved by recycling, let's do that. Lord, if mankind can be saved by any other way other than me having to go to the cross and drink this cup of wrath, there's a crisis of the will. Lord, I'm willing to do that, but I love this. I love this about Jesus. I want you to see it here. Father, if it is your will, take this cup away from me. Now, I'm going to say something, and if it offends you, so be it. There are a lot of faith teachers out there. They say this, and they charge you $20.95 to read their books. And they will tell you, and I've read some of them, just for the point I want to make here. Not because there's theology in it, because there's not. And they will tell you that you should never, ever, 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 ever pray if it be your will. You should have enough faith, and you should grab the bull by the horns, and you should never pray doubting God. You should always pray, name it and claim it, and blab it and grab it. You should never pray if it be your will. Can I tell you something? I'm going to take Jesus over the books. If Jesus said it's okay to pray for God's will, then I think it's okay for me and you to pray. Lord, if this be your will, if this be your will, because here's what Jesus' philosophy was. Jesus' philosophy wasn't name it and claim it. His philosophy was request it and then receive it and move forward. If it be your will. If it be your will, Lord, what is your will, Lord? What is your will? Lord, I'm struggling whether I should do this or whether I should do that. It's okay. Father, whatever your will is, I want to do it. Jesus was going to the cross. He just wanted to know if there was any other way that it could be accomplished other than him having to take that cup of wrath. So he learned a lesson in the crisis of the will. If it is your will, verse 42, take this cup. What's the cup? It's not the cup of suffering. It's the cup of wrath. It's the cup of God's fury, the cup of God, the sinless one becoming sin for you and me, that the Father would turn his back on his Son, that God would turn his back on Jesus, and Jesus would pay the ultimate price for our sins. It's not the suffering. It's not the pain. It's the cup of wrath and the fury of God that would be poured out on the sinless Son of God. That's what he's talking about. He's contemplating this in a place in a garden where he's going to be squeezed like a pit, like an olive pit that's going to be squeezed and he's going to be crushed. But he wants to do the Father's will. And here's what he said. Here's his answer. Verse 42. Nevertheless, Lord, I'll do whatever. Here's what God's will. When you choose God's agenda over your agenda, you've just said nevertheless. Not my will, Lord. It's not my will that I want. I want to accomplish your will. I want to do what you want me to do. So in the midst of this garden, in the midst of being in this pit, Lord, my prayer is nevertheless, whatever you want to do, whatever you want to accomplish, however you want to accomplish it, Lord, I'm willing to be ministered to. I'm willing to minister, and I'm willing to get rest. I'm willing to request something from you, Lord, if there's any other way. But I'm also willing to rest when you tell me that there is no other way. And the only way for Jesus, for the sins of the world to be paid for is through Jesus Christ. So Lord, I'm going to do it. I'm willing. The God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, willing to do it. Nevertheless, maybe you're here this morning and some of you need to resign and say, nevertheless, Lord. Nevertheless, in my pit, in my circumstance, in my, Lord, whatever you want to accomplish, nevertheless. And here's what he says. Look at this. Not my will be done, but yours. I can save you $21. I can save you $21. Request it like Jesus. Receive it and rest in it. Not name it and claim it. Here we go. Look what happened next. there was divine assistance. This is what happens to you and me. When we begin to follow God's will, when we begin to follow the one who's true, when we begin to follow the ones that's faithful, we receive divine assistance. I don't know if you believe in angels, but I do. And it says here that an angel appeared to him from heaven, strengthening him. An angel appeared, and the idea of the text and the rendering of the New Testament here would be that angel was already coming to strengthen Jesus. He had already been in the process of strengthening Jesus. When he said, "Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done," there was an angel that was already dispatched, and that angel was a ministering spirit, and that angel was already ministering to the Son of God. Think about that. In your time of coming out of the pit, in your time of loneliness, in your time of saying, "Nevertheless, Lord," sometimes God sends angels to minister to us. You've been down long enough. You've been down in the pit long enough. And as you come out of this situation, I'm going to have my hand upon you. I can remember several times when I was traveling and back from student camps like Jeremy does, and it's in the middle of the night, 2-3 in the morning. And I remember a specific time when we were all tired. We had just ate a Whataburger. If you've ever been to Texas, Whataburger is king. It rules, and so does Jesus. And French fries, fancy ketchup, and a good old Whataburger. And I remember it was about 2 o'clock in the morning. We had just gotten Whataburger, and we were supposed to be at the church at 3 o'clock, 3 or 3:30 in the morning. And I was thinking about this as I was studying, that God sometimes, angels are ministering spirits. And I remember we were coming down 45, coming home less than a few minutes from the church, and there was a major, major 3 in the morning crash. I mean, major crash. I mean, cars piled up, fortunately, by the grace of God. Angels ministering, I believe, we were not hurt. And I remember getting out, and we were like first responders. There was nobody else. We were first responders. And we went there, and myself and the student minister that was there at that time, we opened the car door, and there was a lady in a pool of blood. I mean, there was no way she could have been alive. It just looked like she was gone. And it was just excruciating pain just in your spirit, in your heart, and you're tired. And I'm thinking, Lord, why wasn't that us? Why wasn't that us? And I really believe that there were angels that were ministering at 3 o'clock in the morning. And we tried to get in touch, and we helped responders as we could, and we even tried to follow up, and by the grace of God, this lady was flown to Herman, and she ended up making it as we ended up tracking it. But what I want you to see here is, and an angel appeared to him from heaven, strengthening him. We get strength from God. We get strength from God's messengers at times. Times when we're going through the pit. Times when it's lonely. Times where we just feel like giving up. And there's divine assistance. You say, Freeman, do you really believe in angels? Oh, yes, I believe in angels. Because there's an angel that says he came and ministered to Jesus. There were angels as he went to the cross. And by the way, the angel, when Jesus died and he was put in that tomb, the Bible says, and the angel came and rolled away the stone so the living God could come out in the power of the Holy Ghost. Do you believe in angels? I do. I believe in divine assistance. Do you see what's happening here? Jesus going through Gethsemane, being squeezed. Nevertheless, not your will be done, Lord. Nevertheless, not my will be done, but yours be done. And an angel came and strengthened him. Look at the text. This is powerful. And in agony, verse 44. And being in agony, he prayed more earnestly. Then he sweat. His sweat became like great drops of blood falling to the ground. When he rose up from prayer and had come to his disciples, he found them sleeping from sorrow. You can be so sorrowful that you sleep. Then he said to them, "Why do you sleep? Rise and pray, lest you enter into temptation." Now let me give you a lesson here. The next one is this, a lesson in betrayal. We have a lesson in loneliness, a lesson in the crisis of the will, a lesson in nevertheless, a lesson in divine assistance, and now we have a lesson in this particular scripture of betrayal. Look at the text, verse 47. And while he was still speaking, behold, a multitude. And he who was called Judas, one of the 12, went before them and drew near to Jesus to kiss him, to kiss him. But Jesus said to him, "Judas, you are betraying the Son of Man with a kiss." When those around him saw what was going to happen, they said to him, "Lord, shall we strike him with the sword?" Now, there's a lesson in betrayal. For those of you that are in the pit, listen to me. Jesus just washed Judas's feet in the upper room. He just blessed Judas. And the very one that he just blessed and donned the towel and washed his feet betrayed him. One of the things that you need to learn in the Christian life when you come out of the pit is the very people you have blessed will end up betraying you. The very people that you've blessed, the very people that I've blessed will be the very ones that betray us. They will betray us. We've blessed them. We've loved them. We've ministered to them. And they will turn their back and they will walk away. And that will happen. But listen to me. What Calvary does in this Gethsemane experience that Jesus said, nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done. The blessing of betrayal is forgiveness. Because what you and I can do, rather than holding bitterness to the one that's betrayed us, and in fact, in Mark, the gospel explains it like this, that there's a strong bond between rabbi, teacher, and rabbi and student. And the Bible says that Mark referred to Judas as master. He said, master, master. He came with a facade of love. Jesus had blessed him in the upper room, and now the one he blessed betrayed him. And that's one of the gifts of Gethsemane. The very people who have blessed us, man, that they'll betray us, but here's the gift of Gethsemane. We can still forgive them. Jesus knew this. It was in the plan of God. It was in the plan of God for Judas to betray Jesus. And Jesus just kept on with his mission. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done, Lord. And so forgiveness is the blessing that we receive in the pit. Not bitterness, but blessing. The blessing of God's forgiveness. If you've ever been hurt by someone, what you always think about is, if I ever get a chance, if I ever get a chance to get them back, I'll get them back. I know you're more spiritual than me. You've never thought that. But, you know, we think that in our lives. We think, you know, if I ever get a chance, and listen, one phone call can cost them a job. One reference can cost them a job. But because you've been in the garden, because you've been in the pit, because you've realized the forgiveness that has been given to you, and the blessing of being betrayed, you now understand is the forgiveness of the cross and the forgiveness of Calvary. You can turn around and you can bless the very people, the one whose diseased heart committed the betrayal in your life. You can forgive them and you can love them because of all that Christ is to you. There's a lesson in betrayal here to be learned. Let me give you a fifth thing, and this one you may not see it. Look at what happened here. This is incredible. This is all coming out of the pit. So now Jesus is coming out of this garden. He's been strengthened by an angel. He's learned the lesson of betrayal because he has a friend with a facade of love coming to him. And remember, he's already received what he needed through prayer. He's already not named it and claimed it. He's already said, hey, I request this, and I'm at rest, and I'm at peace, and I'm going to the cross. Watch this. Here's the gift that many of you need to receive today from the Holy Spirit. And it's the gift of restraint. Look at Jesus. Look at the text. I'm not making this up. It's beautiful here. But Jesus, 48, said to him, Judas, are you betraying the Son of Man with a kiss? When those around him saw what was going to happen, they said to him, Lord, by the way, another gospel says it was Peter. Is it a surprise? Lord, Peter, shall we strike them with the sword? Look at this. And one of them struck the servant of the high priest and cut off his ear. But Jesus answered and said, permit even this. And he had to reattach the guy's ear. Now, Luke was a doctor. And this is right. You've got to learn the lesson of restraint. Here's what happens. When you've been in the pit, when you've been hurt, when you've been wounded, when you've been betrayed, there's a tendency not to use the lesson of restraint. There's a tendency to let it all out when there's an opportunity to let it out. But Jesus used the lesson of restraint. He said, listen, in strength and mercy and calm that I have received when I said, Lord, nevertheless, not my will but yours be done. I am going to the cross. Peter, get out of my way, even if I have to go and pick up an ear and put it back on the guy that you just swung and tried to get his head. Peter, listen to me. I'm going to the cross. I have resolved in my heart and my mind by being in this garden of squeezing. I am learning the lesson of restraint. How do we know that? Because the Bible says Jesus could have wiped them all out. He could have wiped everybody out on that scene. He could have wiped every single person out. Now listen to me. When you go through the Garden of Gethsemane, be careful. God may just give you the power to ruin somebody. He may give you the power to ruin somebody. He may give you the power to say a word, to do something that would just tear them down rather than build them up. But what you've realized is the lesson of restraint. Just like Jesus uses the lesson of restraint, you realize that there's bigger fish to fry and there's bigger blessings to catch. And so you're not going to get down and go to somebody's level and start saying things about them. You're going to rise up and say, Lord, I'm choosing your will, I'm choosing your way, and I'm going to use the lesson of restraint. I'll tell you, my wife's done this many times with me. I remember going through, she didn't cut, this is my real ear. Never mind. I remember I resigned from a job in Chattanooga. I was a quarter of the way through seminary. And I was trying to get through seminary, and the balance of getting through seminary and my job, I just felt it was time for me to move on from this church that I was in. I didn't have a job. I was putting my application out at schools to be a substitute teacher, by the way, is great ministry opportunity. And so I resigned my job, and I went, and I started to finish up seminary, and it took me through that job in Chattanooga to finish. I was working on seminary there. And just one word, I didn't have a job. We were barely making ends meet. And I even acted like I had money in my pocket when I didn't have money in my pocket. But let me tell you what I had. I had a million-dollar woman on my left arm who never used an opportunity to say something to me that would degrade me and consume me with fear and frustration. She said, this too shall pass. You will get through this. We'll be okay. And we went from there, and I still had to be in Dallas, and I had to finish up seminary. And never once, when she had every opportunity to offer not restraint, but to offer words of discouragement and words that would have hurt me deeply, I kept acting like I had money in my pocket when I didn't, but I had a million-dollar woman on my arm, and that's the lesson of restraint. God will put you in a position where you can hurt somebody, but we choose a higher plane, and we choose to live a higher way, just like he did. Just like he did. He chose the lesson of restraint. He could have wiped everybody out. He could have called on the angels, 10,000 angels, to rescue him. He said, Peter, this is what I'm reading between the lines, Peter, get out of my way. Let me get the guy's ear back on. I'm going to the cross. I'm coming out of Gethsemane because Gethsemane is a garden. The Garden of Eden represented a garden of life at one point until it became a garden of death. But the Garden of Gethsemane for you and me represents new life. New life in the power of the Holy Spirit, the power of the Holy Ghost, where Jesus went into a garden, not like Adam and Eve, where they hid from God. Jesus went into the garden submitting his will to the Father's will and saying, I'll do what you want me to do. I'll use the lesson of restraint with the lesson of betrayal, with the value of loneliness, and I'm not counting on my friends to get me somewhere where they need to take me. I'm going to pull away from the crowd, and I want to get a word from you. Here's what some of you need to do today. You need to hear from God instead of other people. You need to hear from God. You need to hear from the friend whose name is Jesus. Value these things. Look at the text, the value of loneliness, the value of the crisis of the will, the value of the spirit of nevertheless, the value of divine assistance when the angel came strengthening, the value of prayer, the value of betrayal, and then the value of restraint. Be careful. God may just let you get back at somebody. And when you're squeezed at that moment, if you come out, look out. But if he comes out, there's going to be a blessing and there's going to be bigger fish to fry. And for some of you, you've been hurt by an ex-spouse, an ex-family member, and you need to bury the hatchet today. You say, Lord, I want to use the lesson of restraint that you used. I want to give the gift of forgiveness in betrayal like you did in that garden. Because one day I'm going to be in this other garden over here in Revelation chapter 22, a picturesque, perfect garden with a river running through it, with a tree of life. And that's where I'm headed. So you can come out of your pit today, but you need to make a decision to say, nevertheless, Lord, not your will, not my will, but yours be done. Would you pray with me this morning? We're going to sing a song in just a moment. And before we sing this song, you already know what you need to do. You already need to know that some of you have way too many friends that are primary support for you. Listen, your friends are not primary support. They should be secondary support. Just like Jesus, his friends weren't primary support. He knew they were going to fail, but he wasn't depending on them. It was the Father's will for him to go on. And some of you might need to change friends. Or you might need to say, Lord, I've got 100 friends in my garden tonight. I don't need 101. And you just need to withdraw today. You need to say, Lord, during this invitation, right where you stand, right where you sing, you need to say, Lord, I want to hear from you. I want to know what it is that you want me to do. I want to value our relationship. I want to value loneliness. Some of you here this morning, you're struggling with God's will. Can I tell you, it's okay. So did Jesus. And he was God. That's a whole nother sermon. It's okay to struggle. But when God tells you to do something, then you respond and do it. Lord, nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done. For some of you here this morning, there's a person that comes to your mind when you think about being betrayed. You think of a family member. You think of a friend. You think of someone in a church. And you just need to say, Lord, I want to learn to bless the person that betrayed me with all the power of the Holy Spirit that lives inside of me. Turn my heart toward blessing, not toward bitterness. And God, if I ever get the opportunity to get back at someone, remind me that vengeance belongs to you, not to me. Vengeance is mine, says the Lord. And some of you can come to a position today and learn the lesson of restraint and forgiveness because we have a friend in Jesus. If you're here this morning and you feel oh so lonely, it's possible that you've never met Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. And in the midst of your loneliness right now, God is drawing you to himself. And he's saying, my son Jesus, not only did he go through the Garden of Gethsemane, but he followed up and went to the cross. And then they buried him. And on the third day, he rose again. And he's alive forevermore. And so this morning, you can trust Jesus as your Savior. And if you would do it right where you are, say, dear Jesus, come into my heart and change me. I feel so lonely. I feel so alone. I'm about to die. And he'll say, I'll come in and be a reservoir of life to you. I'll let rivers run through you. My spirit will run through you and heal you from your wounds and your scars. Trust him as Savior today. Others of you, you know what you need to do. You just need to lay it down, whatever it is you need to lay down. When we sing this song of confession, it demands a response from us in whatever way we're to respond. Jeremy and I will be at the front. If you want to come to the altar, that's fine. If you want to pray where you are, kneel where you are. If you want to just draw a circle around yourself where you are and say, Lord Jesus, speak to me. Speak to me right now. I listen to you and you alone. Father, you do what only you can do. for your power and for your glory. Take our broken hearts and lives and put them back together, because there's bigger blessings to catch. In Jesus' name, what a friend we have in Jesus. Would you stand? However God leads you, you respond.
What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear.
Jesus, what a friend.
Jesus, what a friend we have in Jesus. Jesus, what a friend we have in Jesus. And have we trials and temptations? Trouble anywhere, we should never be discouraged. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Can we find a friend so faithful, who will all our sorrows share? Jesus knows our every
this morning. Jesus, what a friend we have.
Jesus, what a friend we have in Jesus. Oh, Jesus, what a friend we have in
says in John 15 that greater love has no man than he lay down his life for his friends. Jesus is the ultimate friend. So as you leave today, we If you need ministry, if you need prayer or encouragement, we have a hospitality response room. It's just right out these double doors to my left and your right. And so if we can pray with you, encourage you, if you need to know the Lord Jesus as your Savior, there's no reason you can't know Him before you get into your car. So let somebody know. If you have questions, you're not sure, we want to tell you about the one who's changed our life. Thank you for coming today. We appreciate it. We love you guys. You're dismissed. Holy
God, like you. Thanks for watching today. As we kind of wrap this service up, the most important thing is, what have you done with Jesus Christ? We believe that all of life's answers are found in Him. And we preach that Jesus Christ has been crucified, He has been buried, and He rose again on the third day. So if you've never trusted Jesus as your Savior, would you do that today? Invite Him to come into your heart. He'll forgive you of all your sin, He'll give you a new start, and He'll give you something worth living for, and that's His life. If you could communicate that to us via email, we have a website you can go to and just shoot us an email. If we can help you with any questions, we'd be glad to. Also, if you'd like to call us, 865-982-2661. Thanks for watching. God bless.